Monostable multivibrators, or simply monostables or monoflops, can be used to create pulses. They have two states, whereas one state is stable and the other one is unstable. A monostable will stay in its stable state until an external trigger causes it to flip. It will stay in the other state for a defined amount of time until it falls back to its previous stable state. So let us have a look at how we can build such monostable multivibrators and what we can use them for. We cover bistable or astable multivibrators in our other videos. We can build a simple monostable by using an AND gate and putting some inverters in front of one of the AND gate's inputs. The inverters simply add some delay to one of the paths. Let us assume the input is on low. This also means that the output is low, as the AND gate inputs are low and high. But what happens if the input changes to high? The high input value propagates to the AND gate quite fast over the path without inverters. This forces the AND gate to switch its output to high, as it sees two high values. You can also see this in the timing diagram. Within this short time, the high input value also propagates through the inverters, whereas each inverter adds some delay into the path. Finally, in this case, after three inverter delays, the input change also reaches the second input of the AND gate. Now the AND gate sees a high and a low value and switches back to low. If the input changes from high to low, nothing happens, as at least one AND gate input remains low. So this monostable is sensible to rising edges of the input. With this, we have examined our first monostable. Whereas the low output corresponds to the stable state and the high output value corresponds to the unstable state. The pulse width of this monostable is defined by the sum of all inverter delays. Usually, these inverter delays are in the range of nanoseconds, and therefore this monostable is only suitable to produce pulses of short width. We can create another monostable that is sensitive to falling edges on the input, by replacing the AND gate by a NOR gate. We can simulate this behavior again. When the input is low and it goes to high, nothing is happening, and the output remains low. If the input is changing from high to low, the output switches to high until the delayed input reaches the second NOR gate input. But what if we want to have monostables with pulse widths that are longer than a few nanoseconds? We could, for example, use the following circuit consisting of an RC network followed by an inverting Schmitt trigger. Additionally, we introduce an NMOS to discharge the capacitor. If the input is high, the NMOS will pull the input of the Schmitt trigger to low and the output will be high. If the input switches to low, the capacitor is charged. The output will drop to low as soon as the upper threshold voltage V down is reached. The pulse width can be calculated by an exponential equation that is valid for charging a capacitor. By reformulating this equation and inserting proper threshold voltages and component values, we get the pulse width T. Similar to a latch, this monostable is triggered by a steady state, in this case a high being present on the input. However, we can make this monostable edge triggered by adding the monostable from before. It is important to note that this monostable creating long pulse widths is what we call retriggerable. In the timing diagram, the functionality of a retriggerable monostable becomes clear. Every input pulse causes the capacitor to discharge quickly. After this short pulse, the capacitor is charged slowly until either the capacitor voltage reaches the upper threshold voltage, V up, of the inverting Schmitt trigger, or another pulse causes a discharge. This means that every pulse restarts or resets the time of how long the monostable can stay within its unstable state. Such a retriggerable monostable can be used as a watchdog to monitor the correct function of a clock signal, for example. If the clock does not switch anymore, the monostable could go into its stable state and indicate a fault. Now that we have talked about a retriggerable monostable, we could also ask ourselves how a non-retriggerable monostable could look like. Have a look at this circuit that looks similar to the one before. But instead of our short pulse monostable, we use an SR latch to supply and control the NMOS transistor. Let us assume the output Q is low. A high signal at the set input of the SR latch will cause the output Q to flip to high, which is the positive supply voltage. This will initiate the charging of the capacitor. If the voltage at the capacitor reaches V up, the comparator will reset the SR latch, which causes the NMOS to pull the input of the comparator to low. The pulse width again depends on the comparator threshold voltage and the values of R and C. The main difference to the retriggerable monostable from before is that no matter how often we set the SR latch within one cycle, we cannot change or restart the time that the monostable is in its unstable state. Please be careful with the term non-retriggerable. This monostable can be triggered more times, but only if it is in its stable state. So, retriggerability refers to the possibility of extending the time that a monostable is in its unstable state. With that, you have now received an overview of different implementations and types of monostable multivibrators. What they all have in common is that they have a stable and an unstable state. We showed how to create short and long pulse widths, discussed retriggerable and non-retriggerable monostables, and showed where to use them. I'm Dominik with the Institute of Electronics. We hope you have learned something today. But anyway, thanks for watching.